Qigong number 9, Tung Tzu Bai Fo, Back to the Future. The full series of Wudang Qigong consists of 18 exercises, but we mainly focus on the first 10. That is because, as by now you know, these are the exercises that teach us about the two heavenly orbits. In the last few sessions, I have tried to explain to you how what teachings are handed over to us by means of which exercise. Now we are at the point, exercise number 9, where I have to admit that this one was really difficult to uncover. It has made me think back about what my teacher had to say about these exercises. The point is that he seemed to not say much about the reason behind the exercises. Usually, his answer was, just practice. And that was it. But finally, after some years, I got him this far that he was okay with teaching a workshop in which he would explain the ins and outs of this particular Wudang Qigong, which, after all, had originated in his family. And as usual with this type of activities, I did not have to pay as long as I wrote a report on the workshop to hand out to all partakers. After all, at the time, I still spoke Chinese and I could translate his writings and explanation. Now, I must say that at the time, I was really, really disappointed with what he brought forth. It was, so it seemed, a totally unintelligible pile of information and really, really difficult to translate. That is how I started my own investigation, which took me over 25 years and counting. So here we are at this 9th exercise, and I must admit that I have always found it difficult to place. Where the other exercises are quite clear and specific, I have always had a hard time explaining this one. So I was browsing my old notes, and I can tell you, if they were on paper, I'd have a room full of them. And while looking through them, I found a document of which I could not remember what it was about. So I opened it, and lo and behold, it contained my notes on my teacher's workshop. I had no idea that I still had them. So in my search for the reason behind exercise number 9, I started reading them, rereading them. And soon it became clear that throughout all these years, I had totally misjudged his explanation. It was me who was, at the time, not ready for this information. For instance, he starts his introduction with the explanation of how these Wudang Qigong exercises are, in fact, a Neidan Shu, an art of internal alchemy. Nothing new here, I hear you think, and you are correct. Then he continues this nothing new with explaining the transformation of Jing into Qi into Shen. But then he does something that you won't easily find in any book. He states that, and I quote, obtaining the essence of the art of internal alchemy has a close relationship to the ideas about the circulation of the qi and blood systems as they are found in the traditional Chinese medicine, end quote. And somewhat further in the text, he states that if one wishes to practice up to a high level, one has to have knowledge of the 12 organ meridians and the 8 extra meridians. Besides that, one has to mobilize the internal Jin Qi, the true Qi, and accept the idea that following a certain pattern of meridians and lines, as well as following a certain pattern of movement, there is the circulation of a certain force throughout the body. End quote. What a sentence. Well, again, that may be nothing new to you because you have heard me say things like this very, very often. But reading this again was to me a revelation, as it meant that this apparently was not my own addition, but something that had been planted inside me by my teacher, whilst I had totally forgotten, or just not noticed, that he had done so. Now, what he actually says is that in order to understand your Qigong practice, it is most imperative to have a thorough knowledge of Chinese medicine as well. And the fun fact is that by now I have acquired this knowledge, well, up to a certain standard, that is. And it made me read his explanation this time totally different from how I had read and understood it before. Because, like I said, at the time I had no idea what he was talking about, and lots of his explanation was totally lost to me. So I feel you. Well, for instance, after his introduction in which he talks about the transformation of Jing into Qi and Qi into Shen, he continues by explaining about the qualities of the different types of energy, like the pre-heaven and post-heaven Jing, the Yin Qi and the Wei Qi, and the Jin Qi. And I know that by now some of you will feel lost, just as I did at the time of this workshop, and think, what the heck is he talking about? Just forget about these details. Not that they are not relevant, but it is too much for now. What is relevant is some of the things he said about Wudang Qigong. Like, for instance, that although his explanations concern the subject of Qi, as soon as he talks about the idea behind the Wudang Qigong, he explains that Wudang Qigong is all about stretching the muscles and tendons and to move the blood. Well, there are a lot of details he explains, too much and way too far away from the subject of this lecture. He goes really deep into the heavenly orbits, into the function of focusing on the Hun and the Po as representatives for Yin Qi and Yang Qi, and yes, I did not know what these were at the time either. He continues with general, but way too deep, remarks on Wudang Qigong, and emphasizes the importance of standing and of reversed abdominal breathing. The point being that in hindsight, I have totally misjudged his teachings about Wudang Qigong at the time. And I most assuredly have to take back my remarks that he didn't explain us anything. He did explain, only it was us, or me, who did not understand the explanation. But I was searching for information on Qigong number 9, so let's return to that. And luckily, in this workshop, he also explains the exercises step by step, but in a totally different manner, of course, than I have explained them to you. So what was he saying about exercise number 9? Not much, really. He says, and I quote, "As soon as one arrives in the side position, one has to feel the acupuncture point, Lie Chue, close to the wrist. From there, we can feel the qi continuing its flow through He Gu to Lao Gong. It gives us a round feeling. This exercise is, because of the inner purification, good in the case of kidney complaints." And that was it. Lie Chue is an acupuncture point on the inside of the wrist, there. He Gu, right there. And what did he mention more? Lao Gong, on the inside of the palm, where your middle finger will touch the palm. So these three points you can feel. Well, anyway, that was it. Now, all his explanations about the exercises are like this. And although I, of course, am thankful for the information given, it does in no way explain the story of the 10 exercises. And with the story, I refer to my own explanation about why the first exercise is the first, the second, and so on, and how exercises 1, 2, 3 work up to number 4, things like that. This is how I read these exercises as two short series. The first one leading you up to being able to understand the smaller heavenly orbit as it is being practiced in exercise number four. Then comes exercise number five, being an in-between exercise in order to reconnect the limbs to the entire chi system. And after that, number five is being followed by exercise 6 to 9, who help you build you up in order to being able to understand the larger heavenly orbit as taught by exercise number 10. So actually you have 1 to 4, 5, and 6 to 10. And in this story, exercise 6 connected our chi system from hands to feet by means of the double spiral. Exercise 7 connected the yang qi rising through the back to the yang qi rising through the legs as well by means of the tap on the back, the dragonfly skimming the water. And exercise number 8 helped us facilitating the descent of the yin qi into the feet. But number 9? So here I was, still being stuck at number 9 and not really understanding what it actually was there for. Until some years ago, I was practicing the Wudang Qigong and focusing on the heavenly orbits, which at the time were, I admit it, were merely a theoretical concept to me. I understood how they were supposed to work, but I had merely a superficial access to the actual experience. Then I encountered the fire standing position, the one that you can only hold onto for a couple of minutes at the most, but which in a very short time generates a lot of yang qi. In fact, it generates so much yang qi that, as a consequence, it became possible to feel the empty space between skin and flesh that I have been talking about in the discussion on the qigong exercises 3 and 6. And this experience gave me the insight that there is something going on with these two heavenly orbits. When you read the books describing these orbits, you'd get the idea that the larger heavenly orbit was nothing more than an extension of the smaller heavenly orbit. That the larger heavenly orbit, in fact, was the same as the smaller heavenly orbit, just larger, including the limbs. Now I found out that this was not true. The two orbits operate at the very same time, but on a different level, in a different layer, so to speak. The smaller heavenly orbit consists of just yang qi rising through the back and yin qi descending through the front, and it circulates in between skin and flesh. The larger heavenly orbit, on the other hand, happens just on the outside of the body, just over the skin, and surrounds the entire body. So not only yang qi rising through the back and yin qi descending through the front, something happens at the sides, at the flanks of our body as well. This was the experience and insight that I needed in order to understand the peculiarities of exercise number 9. And how to get there is explained by the name of the exercise. The name of exercise number 9 is in Chinese, Tongzibaifo. It literally It literally translates into the boy or the lad pays respect to the Buddha. And as usual, this is not what it says. First of all, the word Tongzi. Yes, it is a boy. Usually, Tongzi is being used for boys in between the ages from 6 to 12. But there is more to it, only English has no word for it. The Dutch language, strangely enough, does. In Dutch, you say knapje. The point is that the word not only refers to a young boy, but also to the fact that he is still a virgin, a very, very important aspect in Qigong and Neidan, because in men, Sex is a very important factor in disturbing the state and the quality of Jing, your founding energy. Yes, I hear the question mark, but what about women? I will get to that another time. Sorry for that. But it means that this exercise implies that, thanks to our practice of the first 8 exercises, we now have been able to still the Jing. Then there is the mention of paying respect to the Buddha. This is less difficult or far sought, as praying and paying respect is part of our culture as well. There are, however, some differences. One is that in Asian cultures, the deity you pray to always is in a higher position. If it is on your own height, then you lower yourself by going down on your knees, for instance. The other possibility, although they are often combined, is that you make a bow. Another difference is that in Christianity you just fold your hands to pray. However, in Asian cultures, and this was very much the same in our ancient European cultures, you offer something to the deity. In Asia, you still do this by holding burning incense candles in your hands. So here we get to the idea of offering something to somebody in front of you. Again, we have to look at how Asian cultures differ in this from our own way of doing this. In Asian, or anyway in Chinese culture, the mutual social position was, and still is, very, very important. If the other person is considered of a lower status than you, then you give him or her something by holding your offering hand in a downward position. Remember, since you hold the higher position, the other person will factually be lower than you, usually because of a bow, with the knees to the ground. So this is self-explanatory. If the other person is of equal status, you give something more or less the European way, just straightforward. But if the other person is of a higher status, and there is nothing of a higher status than a deity, in that case, you lower yourself and you reach out to hand your offering over, whereby you hold your hands higher than your head. So here we are in exercise number 9. We are lowering ourselves, holding our hands higher than our head, and we are reaching out towards, in this case, the Buddha. This reaching out has, if you do this from a Qigong experience, certain physical sensations as a sort of landmark. That is why my teacher talked about the acupuncture points that will deliver sensations. Lie Chue on the inside of the wrist, and from there he said we can feel the Qi continuing its flow through He Gu to Lao Gong. But then he added, as you might remember, it gives a round feeling. And it took me years to understand what he meant by that, and getting to that understanding was not made any easier by the fact that actually this 9th exercise is a bit an odd man out. It is the only exercise where you tilt and rotate sideways, and it does not compare to the exercises that prepare you for the smaller heavenly orbit. There we have, of course, exercise 1 through 3, where exercise number 1 compares to exercise number 7. They both concern themselves with the Yang Qi rising. Then there is exercise number 2, which compares to exercise number 8, both of which concern themselves with Yin Qi descending. And there is exercise number 3, which compares to number 6. These two exercises both focus on the spiral, thus opening the sides in exercise number 3 and linking top and bottom of the Chiang Mai system in exercise number 6. So now we have covered 1, 2, 3, 6, 7 and 8. And 5 was a standalone exercise meant to bridge the gap between not using and using the limbs. And then there are, of course, the orbital exercises 4 and 10. That makes exercise 9 into an extra exercise. For those who did not follow, exercise 1 equals to 7, 2 to 8, 3 to 6, and 4, of course, to 10. So there actually should have been 9 exercises instead of these 10. Number 9 seems to not fit into the story. I only uncovered its function after finding out about the fire standing, the empty space between skin and flesh, and the spiral-like sensation flowing through that empty space. This not only opened up my eyes to exercise 3 and 6, but, after a longer time, to exercise number 9 as well. It is all about the spiral going through the free space between skin and flesh. As you know, the addition of free space is extremely important. It makes the difference between being nowhere and being now here. Now, when you are able to sense the spiral-like sensation in 3 and 6, then now is the time to use this skill in this exercise. Only, as you know, in a sideways manner. Now, when you spiral and after the rising of Yang Qi, since, as you know, Yang Qi is not flexible and it is brittle. So when you spiral and you tilt the body sideways with a forward stretching intention, as the name implies, offering the Buddha, then you activate, stimulate, if you like, the side of the body. Now in Neidan, we divide the body in 3 planes. Yang covers the entire back and the outside. Yin covers the entire front and everything on the inside. Not internally inside, but physically. But as I explained before, there are some differences between the smaller heavenly orbit, which only concerns itself with Yang Qi rising and Yin Qi descending. That leaves a body part in between Yang and Yin unused. This part is called Xiaoyang, thereby referring to the energetic fact that it is neither fish nor fowl. It is a bit of both Yang and Yin, overlapping and constantly changing into one another. This body part has to be covered because there is a second difference between 4 and 10, that is, between the smaller and larger heavenly orbits. The smaller heavenly orbit happens underneath the skin. Here, the side paths are inoperable, simply because of anatomical reasons. The arms are in the way. The larger heavenly orbit, however, happens around the entire body, including the limbs, wrapping it in a field of energy, limbs included. And then the sides suddenly are an integral part of the whole. In order to understand how this spiraling works and how the ninth exercise not only spirals but keeps the up and down of the Chiang Mai system connected, I had to deviate a bit from how my teacher taught this exercise. The point is, for, well, commercial reasons, he gravely adapted all of the exercises in such a manner that, in his words, old people won't get injured when they do it wrong. And that is how we got to the exercise F as I have taught it to you, and the specifications of which we will study now. First of all, how does the movement go? Well, you are in a wider sitting position, which does not show on this camera, but you are familiar with it. And actually, the main thing that you do is that, now we're talking about the physical part, you rise like this. In a side view, it looks like this, but the arms should not be here. They should not be here either. There are a few reasons. One is a mechanical one, and you are already familiar with that because you have heard it over 1,000 times, the shoulder disc. So if the torso rotates, the upper arms rotate. And if the upper arms rotate, the torso rotates, meaning this, but also this type of rotation of the upper chest. And that is exactly what happens in nine. The chest rotates around a horizontal axis. Now I exaggerate. Of course, it shouldn't be this severe, but this is what happens. And again, of course, but on a chi level, you do not focus on rotating the chest, but on opening up the back, facilitating the yang chi, and then the back will straighten all by itself, thus rotating the chest. Shoulder disc. So what you get is when the torso rotates, in this case the chest, the upper arms rotate, you get this. There. And always after a rotation of torso and upper arms, a spiraling action of the forearm follows. So you rotate here, which is hardly possible. Then you rotate there, and then you activate the palm. So what you get is this type of motion there, there. This is one thing that dictates where the hands will end. The second thing, then you have to be a bit further in your qigong development, if you like. The second thing is, how does it feel? In qi, not theory, but awareness, in qi awareness, it is stated, as you might encounter it in ancient Chinese medical textbooks, the hands are the highest part of the qi system, that is. So, when they are here, it's not that they are there, because now the shoulders are locked. The shoulder has to remain open. But if I keep my hand here, then it does not feel as the highest part. Now my head feels the highest. You can experiment with that, of course. Please do. So I invite you to do so. Now the head feels as the highest part. So I have to search. I'm not thinking about rotation or whatever now. I'm just trying to feel at what moment does the hand feel higher than the head without stagnating somewhere in between, because of course now the hand feels higher, but I feel my shoulder as well. And if you feel something, it implies a stagnation. This is a very important thing in qigong. If you feel something, it implies a stagnation, and you are actually practicing qigong to get rid of stagnations. So adjust your position in such a manner that you do not feel. There is a third aspect defining the proper height of the hand, and this is even more difficult, because now you have to be aware of gravity and what gravity does to your body. If you just stand like this, you can center yourself, and without being consciously aware of it, you are actually using gravity to align yourself, because if you stand a bit like this, you will feel your back. Why do you feel your back? Not because it's lifting the top. That is what we tend to think. What happens is that you are being pulled down by gravity, and your back is resisting. It's fighting gravity. Of course, I know it's just different wordings of the same, but the different wordings, that's what it's all about, because wording things differently makes you view things differently. It makes you experience things differently. In this case, gravity. If you keep your arm very relaxed and you keep it forward, then you will feel it becoming heavy. That's a wording. What you are feeling in a different wording is gravity pulling your arm down, and the arm itself fighting it, mainly the shoulder muscles. You will get tired here. What you want is, just like standing in this position, that gravity goes through the center of the body into the feet. Of course, again, that will happen when you hold your hands here, but if you do not align yourself properly, then you will build up a stagnation right there. So you are looking for the lowest high position, and in this case, a high position is not about, I feel the hands being the highest, higher than my head, sorry, but I feel gravity, instead of pulling in this direction, I feel it pulling through my arm and down into my body. And that's a very, very important awareness, because Tai Chi, Bagua, Xing Yi, all types of Qigong, they all use this. And you will notice that maybe you have followed me, I can't see that, but maybe you have followed me in these exercises, testing, is he talking truth, yes or no? And you will have a really warm hand by now. Because it can relax. It's not fighting. Now it's fighting without you realizing it. It's fighting gravity, so there is still some tension. It's not fully sung, as they say. It's not fully relaxed. But here, actually the top of my fingers drops down through the arm, straight down into the body. So although this is a curve, visually, it feels like a straight pipe. And that's the sensation that you're looking for. A straight pipe with a top and a bottom and no stagnations in between. So don't go too high, because you will make a stagnation in the shoulder. So that's about the basic motion and placement of the hands. Now, one thing was said, you honor the Buddha. So not only are you keeping your hands like this, but there has to be an awareness of stretching out, not literally like this, but feel, and the arms will follow slightly, of course, but feel how you offer something and you want to give it, push it away. That's the basic shape and intention of exercise number 9. The only thing that it does different is that it tilts. If you tilt the body, you do not push yourself up with one leg. You rotate the center. And don't make this too difficult by saying, oh, I don't feel how I rotate the center. That's not important. It's about the idea. Because if you rotate the center as an idea, you will pull the leg into its length instead of using the foot and the leg muscles to push you in a tilted position. So you pull yourself into length. Why is this important? You see this often go wrong in internal practice. And in a Tai Chi text, for instance, is stated in a certain old Tai Chi text, how the Qi goes from the foot through the leg, through the chest, through the arm, and it shows itself in the fingertips. So what you see is people pushing themselves from the foot and then making this wave-like motion towards the hand. This is wrong. Why is this wrong? Well, it's easy for you to understand after my previous explanation about gravity. You say? Yes, because tension, physical sensations, equal stagnation. If you push yourself up from the floor with your leg, the muscles will tense up. Yes, in a wave-like motion, but they will tense up, thus creating stagnations in the leg. Another thing is that when the muscles have to work, they do so by using qi. So there is no qi left to flow up. What you want is a fully relaxed leg like you encounter in, well, the fifth qigong, for instance, where you push the qi down, as you might remember, through the leg, through the empty leg, the leg that you are not standing on. So don't think about dantian, something you have to feel inside. Think more simple. You have these two legs, and then you have, well, what we can easily refer to as your gravity center, which, if you relax the abdomen, will feel like a ball being caught in between the standards of these legs. The hips, yes. So you have that ball, and just feel how you rotate that ball, and in that manner, you do not push yourself to the side, pushing yourself through one knee, but you will pull one leg into extension. And now you have, you know, the basic principle of the external principles of Tai Chi, as I've written about in my book. In this case, the double axis from shoulder to foot and from shoulder to hip, making one pipe from head to foot. Don't stand like that. And of course, the hands are already there, but we'll add them later. So you make that pipe. Now, once that pipe is in position, because you rotated your gravity center, your gravity ball, now you have a long pipe resting on a short supporting beam, the other leg. And the connection is, in this case, my right side. This is my right side. And the connecting point is the hip. And what you get is that a pipe is round and it will roll off the supporting beam. And that is why I am turning. I am not making a turn. I am relaxing the hip joint on the inside. And then that rolling result will stop all by itself. Whilst if I force the rotation, I can go back and then, oh, my hip doesn't feel comfortable. No, because you do something. Don't do anything. So it's just like life. If you have to work, it's not comfortable. Holidays, don't do anything. Be comfortable. Qigong is like that. So now if you add the hands, you can focus on the mechanical part, chest and upper arm rotation. You can focus on the yang qi rising, and in that manner, raising the back. Doesn't matter. As long as in the end, as long as the yang qi can first go up before it rotates. So for maybe you have forgotten, maybe you weren't there, I don't know, but I have previously explained the difference between yang qi rising through the back, yin qi going down at the front. Yang qi is hot. And something hot will dry out its environment. The environment will wither. It will become brittle. That is why you have a bony back, a backbone. Not because the energy is not strong enough to keep you up, but because it's yang qi keeping you up. Yang qi is hot. It dries out the environment. So a bone collects around it. And that means that it becomes brittle as well. And so you have to be very careful when facilitating yang qi rising, where you allow the parts of the dumai, actually surrounding the dumai, the backbone, but not literally the backbone, but as an idea it will work. But imagine the Dumai consisting of various short pipes on top of one another, but they are a bit out of the line. And what you have to look for is that when you, for instance, you sit on your legs, just relax the arms, and you know the drill, sit on your legs, soften the back, soften the neck, open the head, sink in the dantian. And then focus on these short pipes on the back. Start below, slightly above the tailbone, because there is a very large part through the entire sacrum. And try to adjust the placement of your hips above the hip joints, so the hip bones above the hip joints. Try to place it, it's very precise, in such a manner, by slightly rotating, till you feel warmth going up. It's not a nice sensation. You will start sweating down there. But once you have found that exact position, in my case, you might notice how my body wants to turn slightly off center. So in your case, well, I don't know. Find out for yourself and give into it. And then stay in that position, continuing that warmth. That's the first thing to try to find. So you try to get a hot tail. Then the short pipe above that. So you rotate a bit, you wriggle a bit, until you feel the warmth going through the soft part of your back. And you continue the hard part of your back, behind the ribs, in between the shoulder blades, the neck, the back of the head. And eventually, it will feel like, you know, a knitting needle, long one, like it's stuck up through your tail, up through your spine, and it's really, really hot. It does not feel nice. But that is the Dumai. And all these parts have to stay in place. So if you are rising your yangqi and you are rotating at the same time, your tower will crumble. First rise and then rotate the entire yangqi axis. Yinqi, on the other hand, compares to water. Water is fluid. It's not necessarily cold, that depends on how deep you go, but it's fluid, and that's why going down, when going down, you can, on the inside, you can slightly rotate, spiral if you like. So remember from this, yangqi, you have to stay straight before and only rotate after you have reached a certain height. Yinqi can go down and spiral into the feet. This is important for this ninth exercise as well. So here you are. Anyway, back to the movement itself, sitting in a wide position, going up, but whilst going up, you rotate at the same time. So you are going straight up. Notice that I have not rotated yet. Only when I'm at the highest point, I'm not extending yet, I'm not offering yet. I've just placed my hands in the highest position. The back relaxed, I feel the yang qi, the fire through the backbone. And then I allow my hip joint to relax. And while rotating, not spiraling, rotating, the lower arms spiral out and I offer by, in my intention, pushing away the palms. And now I feel the points my teacher talked about, Lie Chue, He Gu, Lao Gu. So all these layers, there's a physical layer, there is, there are several awareness layers, they are all working together, of course. So this is how you get into the side position. Now, I just explained that In Nadan, internal alchemy, we divide the body in three parts. So there is a yang, qi part, the back, all the way going there, actually going over the head, over the face, and reaching the upper palate in the mouth. And then there is the yin qi part at the front, going down through the tongue, over the throat, over the chest, then the soft part, slightly below the navel. It does not continue downward, but it goes into the dantian, more or less the center of the body, thereby continuing the downward path, exiting at huiyin, huiyin being the point between the genitals and the anus, and then going up again. That is how the smaller heavenly orbit works. Yang qi rising, yin qi descending. Now we are working towards exercise number 10, where the larger heavenly orbit is taught by the exercise. And for that we have to add, like I just explained, a third layer around our body, because now we have just put a poncho over our heads with just a front and a back, but it's open at the side. And this ninth exercise closes the side, qi-wise spoken. So, not while doing this, but now when rotating and extending, without extending you won't feel it, but if you rotate you allow the hip to relax, and you extend the hands far enough, you will feel the side slightly pulling. If you break, so the top of the torso rotates separately from the bottom of the torso, then you won't feel that. If you have not enough intention, you won't feel it either. If the position is wrong, too straight, actually like in my teacher's book, I'm sorry to say, then you won't feel it either. So search for, actually this is the height, not away, but you know, you're standing like this, but in a tilted position. Search for the proper height where you feel this side slightly being pulled open, this side, the other side, slightly being compressed. There it goes down. And then, of course, you look for the same thing on the other side. Now, there is one very important thing which you will not find in books. And, well, it's my own experience, so maybe I am the fool. But I'll share it with you anyway. So it's because it's never nice to be a fool on your own. Let's be fools all together. When you talk about a qi plane, yang qi over the entire back, yin qi over the entire front, xiao yang over the entire side, so a plane. When you talk about a qi plane, then you can compare that to a roof. And a roof can only stay at being a roof because of supporting beams. Now with the yang qi and the yin qi, you know already about the supporting beams, because the supporting beam of the yang qi is the dumine. The supporting beam for the yin qi plane is the renmai. So what is the supporting beam for the xiaoyang? The in-between yin and yang. The chungmai system. So now we have to look back to the value of the sixth qigong above the third qigong. In the third qigong, as you may recall, I have been talking about the spiral opening up around the arms and then how it reverts downward. And with spiral, don't take this too literally, because a spiral that's imprinted in our brain is a continuous same direction circulation. This is not the case. actually it goes this way, then it goes that way, and then like that. So we have no words for that. So we use the word spiral because it actually feels shortly like this spiral, then shortly like that spiral. And so I'm not referring to the physical visual part, but what I feel in between skin and flesh. So that was the third Qigong. The sixth Qigong being almost the same. We've talked about that. That's a question mark. Why is it always the same? Why almost the same? Why repeat an exercise? Because it's not a repetition. The hand shape is different. And apart from the fact that the third exercise was more yang, and the sixth exercise connects yang to yin, there was something else going on. Yes, the sixth exercise uses that, let me call that, refer to it in this case as an external spiral, external being, meaning that it goes around the arms as well, it wraps me, but it has an internal spiral as well, namely, only this arm, and now I exaggerate, and then spiraling. Well, this arm does nothing, spiraling, 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 and then the spiral, the individual spiral, that is continued in the other arm. But that's not the only thing. We've been talking about spirals as a result of, for instance, the Feijiagong, where you practice this exercise. And we have encountered two types of spirals. There is a continuous spiral, like in the Feijiagong. Continuous meaning that it continues in the same direction. Notice the direction my hand rotates. From my point of view, anti-clockwise. And now I continue that rotational direction, making the arm retract. I'm not retracting the arm, it happens because I continue the same spiraling direction. That's what we call a continuous spiral. Then there is a reverse spiral where you rotate out and then you rotate back. This is what you encounter, for instance, in the third Qigong and in the sixth Qigong. In the sixth Qigong, even on two levels, literally levels, layers. So a deeper layer and a more outside layer, the outside layer being the same as in the third Qigong. The deeper layer, where am I? The deeper layer from individual arm to individual arm. Now this is a continuous spiral. Why? Because watch this arm, it spirals there, but it spirals back, like that. So it does not continue the same rotational direction. The difference between these spirals is really, really important to work with, because it was a reverse spiral, wrong word. The difference is really, really important because a continuous spiral, so I go out with my chi through the chung mai into the palm of the hand, and now I continue that rotation, thus pushing the chi back, continuous spiral. Now the chi will jump over from Chung Mai to the Dantian. So this continuous spiral is often used to pump up the volume, to pump up the Dantian. And after that, that all is always being followed by a release, an expansion, a fajin, if you like. I do not like that word, but I know some of you do. A reverse spiral, however, still opens up the Chung Mai. I still go from there and back. But now it's not strong enough to jump layers, to jump from Chung Mai to Dantian. So it stays in the Chung Mai system, and in that manner, I can connect through the legs to the feet. And that is what the sixth Qigong does, differently from the third. The third stays on top. It opens, it frees you up, it gives you free space between skin and flesh, which is really important for your heavenly orbit, because that is the layer where the smaller heavenly orbit happens. And we do not want to lose that, so we because the smaller heavenly orbit carries the larger heavenly orbit. Like I just said, the larger heavenly orbit is not an extension of the smaller one. It is just a different layer. It is a thing on its own, actually on the outside of the body. Now back to the spiral. In the sixth Qigong, it is important to make the qi system a whole. What do I mean by that? In the fourth Qigong, we have been practicing the smaller heavenly orbit. The arms are a helpful means, but they are not a part of the orbit. The orbit, only yang qi, only yin qi, only the back of the body, only the front of the body, no arms involved. Then you get the fifth exercise, where you have this actually wild moving and spiraling. There you have the reverse spiral as well, thus staying in the Chung Mai system, and in this manner you connect the arms and the legs to the entire qi flow. You reconnect them actually. In six, you make this into a system. In five, it's still a bit separated. In six, you make this into a system. So while practicing the sixth exercise, you have to stay connected through the hip joints to the feet as well. And now we are talking a lot about the sixth Qigong. Why and how, does this relate to exercise number 9, Tung Zhe Bai Fo? Well, actually, because here you do the same. You work on several layers. So yes, there is the yang qi rising. You have to be aware of that. Then, now I exaggerate to show you, while extending, there is on both sides Xiaoyang presence. Here it's being pulled, here it's being pushed, like that. And then I release, and I open up the yin qi. I'm not circulating yet, I'm just opening up and freeing up the yin qi. So that's one layer. Now the Chung Mai system. Like I previously said, if you push yourself up into a tilted position, then it won't work because there's too much tension in the pushing leg. So you have to pull yourself into a tilted position, still having weight on that foot, but the leg itself can relax way more on the inside. It feels a bit like if you relax around the bone, and if you have the proper relaxation, then you will, it's not nice to say, but you will start sweating a bit in the crotch. There you have it. When qi releases, that happens. So what you get is you do not flow from top to bottom or from bottom to top through the Chung Mai system, because the Chung Mai system has no direction. We force direction sometimes with the breathing technique, but it has no direction by itself. Remember that the 8 extra meridians, of which the Chung Mai is the first and most basic one, the 8 extra meridians are compared to lakes. Whereas the organ meridians, lung meridian and so on, are being compared to rivers. They have a direction, they have a flow, they have a surge. Now the Chung Mai system is called the surging, the pumping meridian. So How can you say it pumps if it has no direction? Actually, that's quite simple, gravity. If you open up, and if you are far enough to open up the Chiang Mai system, I mean by that being aware of opening up the Chiang Mai system, qi answers to gravity as well. So it will sink down, thus making a pumping thing. Anyway, back to what I was talking about. The Chiang Mai has no direction up to down. That means that if you want to open up the entire Chiang Mai system, so not only this main meridian, but with its side paths through the arms and through the legs as well, that we have to operate like scissors. Somewhere we declare a center, not relevant at this moment. What is relevant is that the two sides end at the same time. So the stretching of the leg, one, the tilting, and the reaching out with the arms have to end at the very same time. That is very, very important if you want to open up the Chiang Mai system. The Chiang Mai system being the supporting beam in this case for Shaoyang. So you open up there, then you rotate, you don't spiral, you rotate, the full Yang Qi axis rotates, and you slightly push out, thus extending the Yang Qi. Now how do you go back? Again, gravity is your friend. So one thing, you just release the control of your hip joints and you will just rotate and fall back to the center. That's one thing. But we do not like to work with only one thing. No. We want to make it difficult, yes. Again, the spiral. Like I said, we are talking in this case about a reversed spiral. So you start in this direction, and you continue in that direction. There. Now, I start only in one arm. Remember the sixth qigong. I only start in one arm. Now I exaggerate again so you can see what I'm doing. Actually, the hand, the wrist, beyond the elbow, then the upper arm. When and if the upper arm rotates, the torso rotates. So when I pass the point of beyond the elbow, the upper arm starts to rotate. So use the shoulder disc to rotate the torso. But if the torso rotates, the upper arm rotates. So this one rotates out. And like I said, always after that, a slight spiral starts beyond there and there. But now I have, because of the continuous rotation, I have fallen over my central axis. And I'm slightly, very slightly tilting to the other side. And now you can feel the lower arm palm of the hand floating out like that. If you can really feel that, because you are so relaxed, not making the movement, that's too much tension, but it's really loose, like if you, well, I'm so drunk. You just let it float out. Then there is a point where it feels like it goes over a hilltop, and then gravity takes over, pulling my arm slightly, well, actually down, but that means that it falls into an extension. That's too far. So starting from this, one arm starts to spiral. There, there, here, here, here. And now I'm going, let's say, up the hill. And just before the hilltop, I reach the palm of my hand with my awareness, and then that becomes the platform where I push, this arm still being there actually, where I push myself back. I relax or keep the hip joints relaxed. So now I actually fall in between my hip bones, there, centered between the feet. And now, I don't know if you're how biblical you are, but there is this story of Samson being caught by the Philippines and made blind and a slave for many years. And then finally they want to mock him, and they put him at the front of a temple inn, and they tie him up between two pillars. And then he finds that he has his strength back, so he pushes these pillars. That is what you are doing here. So there you start. There goes the spiral. This spiral, upper arm, lower arm. I feel the palm of my hand. I push myself back. When I'm centered, I use two palms and the top of my head to push myself down into the floor. And that's where the Chiang Mai system is connected. And that is how you change sides, of course. Again, doing the same and activate the Shaoyang. So, well, what do I have to say about the ninth exercise besides this? Yes, now my teacher said you will feel round. And that was a funny thing. The point is that you know the exercise you are familiar with about searching the field, and we use a round shape. First of all, this is the position wherein it's, even when you're not fully opened up, it's relatively easy to become aware of a field sensation surrounding you. Another thing which is really, really important, this is where our mind agrees with the concept of being aware of a field, because the idea of the word field is that it's round and it's like a ball we're standing in, and you hear me describe it like that as well. But actually, there is a really strange thing. The field actually is relatively close to your body, but it feels like you stand inside, well, an egg. How that's possible, maybe I can come back on that to you later when I actually understand it, because I have no idea how that is possible, but that is how it works. The field is relatively close to the body, surrounding you, and actually just being a person shape as well, but it feels like a round field. And that is what is happening here. You are completing that field around you. You're not rotating yet, just completing the field. And it feels round. Of course, it also has to do with the exact movement. If you are moving way off, then, well, maybe you feel parts, but you won't have a round awareness. It is also to do with, in this position, at the end where I push myself, where I connect the palms to the feet and the top of the head, the five palms as you know, I have to have a rounded shape. So I'm not standing sideways, a bit there, a bit there, see? Not a curved back. So the top of the head goes straight down, splits through the hips, through the legs, into the feet. Well, and that is what I have to say about the ninth Qigong. So I hope it was not too much gibberish for you. It was really complicated, I know that. Don't worry about that, just enjoy the practice. The only thing I hope you take away from it is that there is more to it than, oh, it feels nice. Yes, of course it feels nice, but if you practice it really properly, well, actually it doesn't feel nice as well. It becomes hot, and as I understand it, it feels like hot flashes now and then. And you need the yin qi to temper that. Anyway, so I wish you a good exercise, because I have nothing to say anymore about exercise number 9. We'll continue with number 10 the next time, which will be the conclusion of this series. Thank you for being here. I hope you Well, enjoyed it, and as usual, stay safe, stay healthy.